Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889, and by French Market Coffee, locally roasted in New Orleans for 125 years. From our studios in the Southern Food and Beverage Museum in New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. On this week's show, we're traveling across the globe in pursuit of the meaning behind a message in a bottle. The first bottle we'll examine is an Irish classic, Jameson whiskey. Before the amber-colored liquor hits the shelves, it spent a good amount of time aging in wooden casks. Ger Buckley, Jameson's master cooper, is the fifth generation of his family to build and maintain those very important vessels. Ger joins us to discuss Irish whiskey history and tradition. Then, we'll visit with a real Italian count. Count Eduardo Branca is the sixth generation of his family to produce Fernet Branca, a bitter liqueur that Italians have loved for over 170 years. Next, we take a trip down under to meet Kathleen Davies, a scrappy Australian woman whose distribution business requires a nip of courage. You won't believe the distance Kathleen will go to in order to bring the craft liquors of Australia into the mainstream. And how would you like to enjoy a lovely libation while having your locks trimmed at the tonsorial parlor? That's the experience Mikey Enright offers at his gin bar and barber shop in Sydney. We've got generations of tradition combined with modern innovation on this week's Louisiana Eats.
So my name is Ger Buckley. I'm the master cooper for Jameson. I'm a fifth generation. So my family have been coopers for well over 200 years.
The practice of making and maintaining barrels by hand, or coopering, is a tradition that goes back over 2,000 years. Using techniques passed down from generation to generation, coopers played a prominent role in history, crafting wooden containers used for transport, storage, and of course, aging whiskey. There were once thousands of coopers working in Ireland, but today there are only four people that carry the title of Master Cooper. Ger Buckley of Jameson Whiskey is one of them. I asked Ger about his relationship with the age-old craft and how he mastered the art of the barrel.
The first evidence of coopering is about 4,000 years ago, about in Egypt. And the theory is that people had hollowed out logs for vessels. And the next logical step is to get individual pieces of wood, join them together, to create a sustainable vessel. And then from then on, it's evolved. The exact same shape, just a cylinder round, is unchanged. So the nice thing about coopering, or the kind of magic of coopering, is that I only have one measuring tool in my whole arsenal of tools, a compass, which measures the top of the cask from my head or for the lid of the cask. Everything else then is done by eye. The joints of the stave, the angles of the stave, everything is done by eye. So that's where the craft of coopering is so special, in that it's all about experience, skill, and using your tools in the right way. And the tools are very specialized. They're very different. Like when I demonstrate coopering now and I show people the way casks were made only one generation ago, that casks were still made by hand. And I show how a cooper's axe was used to carve the stave. And the stave are the long vertical pieces on a cask. So that's some of the techniques I use in building a barrel.
Well, those barrels are very important because they hold a very precious liquid So nothing can seep out.
And that's the skill, that you can make a vessel, such as a barrel, put into a warehouse for anything up to 20, 30, 40 years even, and it won't leak and it'll still come out. Now, timber is timber at the end of the day. There can still be defects. There can still be faults happen with it. And that's where a cooper comes in to repair a cask. But on the whole, that a good cask made properly will last that length of time. And I often say that, and the kind of debate that we have with distillers and everything else is that, you know, without any casks, without any wooden barrels made from oak, you won't have any whiskey. So it's a really important process in the whole thing.
And the wood has everything to do with the flavor of the whiskey, doesn't it?
It does. We only use white oak in the industry. We use various species of white oak. Probably the most popular in the industry is American white oak, because it's got a lot of sweetness to it, a lot of vanilla, and you've got that charred, toasted wood. And the longer the whiskey is in the wood, the more the wood will come into play and influence the taste of the whiskey.
Coopering didn't used to be such a specialized skill, but since the turn of the century, the number of coopers in the world has dropped dramatically.
In the turn of the late 1800s, 1900s in Ireland, it was maybe 8,000 to 9,000 coopers in the country. And again, now making all sorts of vessels. Now it's 4, which is, it doesn't get much smaller than that.
That's shocking. Now, you had the amazing opportunity and advantage of learning from generations of coopers in your own family. Tell me a little bit about your apprenticeship with your father and how this tradition has been passed down from one to another.
Well, previous generations of my family, all my uncles were coopers, my grandfather and his brother. My father went into the distillery originally under my grandfather's brother, Dan was his name, and learned from him. And then I learned directly from my dad. So it's even in coopering, it's unique to actually learn from your own father directly. That was really good, that we could build up that close relationship. Wasn't always a great idea on weekends if you stayed out too late to face your father and work on a Monday, but it was good. I enjoyed it.
Well, how old were you when you went to work at Jameson with your dad?
I done the interview when I was 16, and I just was turned 17 by a month when I started. And giving away my age here now, but I'm reaching 40 years in Jameson this year.
Do you remember the first day?
I do remember the first day. It was daunting. And now looking back, to think that somebody who's just barely over 16 going into a work environment, which doesn't happen really much anymore. I imagine the other coopers were kind of really thought I was so young. I still probably wasn't fully grown. And the work was physical. I mean, the first thing I did the first day I arrived was learn how to put rivets in a hoop.
And how long did you and your father work together?
We worked together for approximately about 7 years before he took early retirement. Whiskey business in Ireland in the early 80s was not going well. Thankfully, with the growth of Jameson, and particularly here in the US, it's absolutely fantastic how well it's doing. And that's why we have an apprentice. He's in his fourth year apprenticeship now. It's a four-year apprenticeship. So I'm very happy that what I know is going to be passed on, and also the kind of nuances of Irish coopering, the kind of vocabulary that I use, which is different to other parts of the world, will continue on. So I'm very pleased with that. I don't have sons, I have two daughters, so I didn't have a son to come into the trade. It's not that there hasn't been any women cooper, that there have been women coopers. I'm not sure my two daughters would appreciate being coopers. And our apprentice, Killian O'Mahony, had been working as a cabinet maker and training as a cabinet maker for a couple of years before he came in. So we had seen some of his work in the interview stage and some tables he made and stuff like that. So quite satisfied that he had a skill level that could be trained. The one aspect of coopering, especially in Ireland, is that once you work for Jameson or get trained up for Jameson, you're kind of signed up for life, because it's not a craft that you can really travel with or change, or it's very specialised. And so the last time we heard the apprentice, which was myself, would have been 37 years earlier. So it doesn't come up very often. So he's now in his fourth year, so he's 1 year to go. And but it'll be a 10 or 12, 15 year really process to get up to a master level and to learn every aspect of the trade. And you know, my job is going to forests as much as working at cooperage, going to visit the suppliers that supply us with barrels and cooperages in Spain and Kentucky. And so, yeah, he's got a big long learning curve yet to get up to speed.
How old is he?
He's now 22.
Ah.
So he's still quite young enough. Yeah, he's doing very well. He's very skillful. He's at 11 now, even after year three, that he can do everything in repairing a cask or making a cask at this stage. What he has to do now really is, like everything else, you just have to practice it and work at it and get better as time goes on.
Well, that sounds like great planning, because it appears that you've got enough years left in your industry for him to catch up to you and everything to continue to go as smooth as Irish whiskey.
As smooth as Irish whiskey. Couldn't put it better myself.
Ger Buckley, Master Cooper for Jameson Whiskey. When we come back from a short break, we'll introduce you to a real Italian count, Count Eduardo Branca of Fernet Branca. Stay tuned. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Rouse's Markets and from the Napoleon House, located in the historic French Quarter, home of the Pimm's Cup cocktail and the toasted muffalata. Lunch, dinner, and private events at 500 Charter Street. Fratelli Branca is a historic Italian distillery established in 1845 that today is well known throughout the world. It's also a family-run business. We had the opportunity to speak to Count Eduardo Branca, a sixth-generation member of the Branca family, about the incredible history of his family's 170-year-old company and about their first and flagship product, Fernet Branca. So tell me about your family's history in Italy. The business goes back to 1845?
Yeah. Yeah, the company actually started before Italy was united, so it's really unbelievable. And one of the most amazing things, I think, was like to create a spirit in 1845 with not your local herbs, but more of an international herb. So they come from four different continents all around the world, except Australia and New Zealand, because Australian was just discovered and New Zealand had yet to be discovered, actually. And like most of the spirits, Fernet Branca was born as a medicine before. And for this reason, actually, we were the only spirits during Prohibitionism to be sold legally, because we were not a spirit, we were a medicine, because was born in Milan in those times were not so nice. It was a little bit dirty and we had a lot of cholera. And so it was born as an anti-choleric, actually. And so you had small batches, because Fernet is aged for 1 year in Croatian oak barrels. And you had this small batch, and in the hospital you have like a spoon and they'll give it to the people because it helps digest. And as well, some of the properties of the herbs, actually, they open the upper part of your stomach and so you will get hungry. And the problem with cholera actually was that you stop eating, you get thin, and then unfortunately you pass away, actually. But that was how it was born, and we did like this for 30 years. And then we said, you know, a lot of people loved it, and so we became a spirit, actually.
So your, let's see, great, 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 great grandfather, was he a pharmacist?
There are two stories, actually. It depends with how you speak. If you speak with I will call them white collar, they will tell you Fernet Branca was done by Mr. Branca. That was an herborist, and with the help with a Swedish chemist that was named Fernet. And instead, if you speak with the workers, they will tell you, no, 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 that's not true. We invented the name because we registered the company in 1845, but we go a couple of years before, actually. And what they will say is, like, when Fernet Branca is produced, actually, you have hot and cold infusion and a little bit of maceration for some of the herbs. But with the hot infusion and with aloe, actually, when you mix it, you have you used to have, like, you know, the Smurf, Gargamel, like the big
Smurf?
Yeah, you know? And, you know, Gargamel with the fire under it and mixing, like, a kind of a potion. And one of the herbs, actually, is aloe. And you had to do it by hand in those time like this. And when you take out the pail, it was really shining and very clear. And in dialect from Milanese, Fernet is clean iron, actually.
Oh.
So it depends really with who you speak. So they will say the workers in the company, they will say, you know what, we are the inventor of the name Fernet. And instead, you know, the white collars will tell you, no, 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 no.
Well, something I'm sure you can probably tell me about, because it wasn't that long ago, was that right before the World War, the second one, really got rolling, someone must have had a vision that it was time to go.
Yeah.
How did that work out?
We used to have a lot of companies all around Europe, Czech, Germany, France, and Switzerland, Italy, and Argentina, and New York, actually. So what happened, we needed to stop most of our production, actually, in Italy, of course, Germany, France as well, actually, we stopped them. But my grandfather, you know, I would call it grandfather to simplify things, but was my great-great-grandfather. He stayed in Milan because the Milan factory is the biggest one. Now we closed all of them apart from the one in Argentina and the one in Italy, actually. These are the two still running. But during those times in Italy, the company had, I think, a little bit more than 800 people. So my grandfather, you know, being a family business, when you have, it's family as well, all the employees, and he had more than 800 people that he had to take care of it. And, you know, I can tell you thousands of stories because, you know, when the Americans came in, we had one of our workers, actually, that had a very bad infection, and you had some American militaries that came and they helped us, actually, inside the company to cure this son of one of our employees. And one of the amazing things, actually, that in our company, it's a little bit different because nowadays, you know, you jump from one company to one job to another one. Most of our employees are second, third, fourth generation. Some of them there is one guy that is fifth generation inside the company. So, you know, it's family because people, you know, they come in, they love the environment. And if you think during the 70s, the Fratelli Branca company, you know, during the weekends will turn in a balera. And balera is like a disco of the 60s and 70s. And we have all the employees coming by on a Saturday night to have, you know, dancing and to meet each other. And as well, you know, being for so long, we have so many family actually that were created because, you know, love newborns and things like this, born and was
somebody's son married somebody's daughter.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. And they started to work then in the company. And it's like unbelievable. It's what I love about, you know, being part of Fratelli Branca, because I'm a part of it. I'm not the owner. I'm, you know, first of all, my father is the owner, but, you know, I'm part of a big family, and I grew up with so many people that are teaching me and about everything, and every day I learn about Fernet. That's the most amazing thing, actually.
So this move to Argentina that sort of happened around 1850, so 5 years after you all began?
Yeah. It was,
why in the world would an Italian company open up a branch in Argentina in 1850?
Okay, allora, I will answer you this question in two different ways. First of all, we moved in Argentina because in Italy used to be a very, very poor country. The southern part of Italy was very, very poor, so a lot of people need to emigrate, and you know it here in the United States. And Argentina during that period was one of the most, let's say, countries where most of the Italians go. So we said, you know, we are going to bring a little bit of Italy with you. And so we moved there. And second of all, it's the history of Fernet Branca is a little bit weird, being so international, being one of the first drinks to have so many different herbs inside. And we immediately, everybody wanted to try this thing that was so international.
So consequently, you all are considered to be the national drink of Argentina?
Yep. We are the national drink of Argentina because they drink it in a different way. Instead of having as a digestive as they do it in Italy, they will have it with Coke. So they will have Fernet and Coke. And if I may add one thing, the most amazing thing about Fernet Branca is wherever you go in the world, they will teach you another way of drinking Fernet Branca. But like Argentina is Fernet and Coke, you will have Italy and Germany and Spain, you will have it as a digestive. Instead, if you go in the northern countries like Sweden, Norway and Denmark, they will consider it a little bit more as a morning drink because they drink, you know, they like to have something a little bit more stronger in the morning. And so they will have their breakfast and afterwards they will have with their breakfast in the morning a Fernet Branca, actually. If you come in the States, here will be more of as a shot or a cocktail ingredient, actually. So it really depends wherever you go around the world is a different feeling of Fernet Branca.
I was fascinated to read that apparently it's very common in Italy for gentlemen to have a little Fernet Branca in their coffee in the morning.
Yeah. We call it caffè corretto. And I will translate it with coffee correct, maybe. I don't know if I'm telling it right, but it's because one of the ingredients inside of Fernet Branca, we have 27 herbs and one of them is Fernet. And then, you know, when you drink coffee without any sugar inside, it's a little bit bitter. And with the bitter of Fernet Branca, it's like a melting pot. And it's amazing, actually. The result that you have it, and it's really, really something that I like. I drink it after my meal sometimes with one ice cube inside, and I will have the Fernet room temperature and an ice cube inside. But then, you know, when I'm out partying with friends, I will have it maybe inside cocktails, and I have maybe one or two, let's put it this way, inside cocktails. Or, you know, if I'm at home by myself, or no, actually, by myself not anymore because I got married in December. So
congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Lucky girl.
Yeah, I will have it. Maybe we'll have a Fernet and Coke with my wife at home and, you know, we'll enjoy ourselves together. So it really depends.
How many employees do you have?
In Italy, I will say a little bit over 80. And then we have agents that will sell on the phone. So we're a small family company. We're not the big guys. And I'm happy about it. And I know that, you know, we'll never be big as one of the, you know, major shot companies or drink companies. But I'm happy because Fernet Branca is something that you need to appreciate and you need to learn. You need to go through some spirits and understand the level of work that we do, and as well appreciate spirits in their most pure way, actually. Because when you drink Fernet Branca, you're part of a group. You're part of my family. It's a family, Fernet Branca.
Count Eduardo Branca, sixth generation scion of Fratelli Branca.
Fernet Branca, drank up with me and my partners, make your breath smell good. I don't need no binocular, just small time drinkers, ain't knowing the beer. Get with this, it's like it's sipping on a licorice stick. For the players, it tastes a little bit like Jaeger, but smoother. Tell me if you're feeling the flavor, take a shot, it's instantly making you hot. Next episode, add a breezy shaking the spot. You could chase it with some ginger ale.
What kind of liquor is Amaro? Stay tuned and we'll answer that question when we come right back.
Holla everyone that walk past. Well, DJ Pause, keep filling up my shot glass. It ain't wine, it ain't beer. It ain't no kind of cognac, it ain't no kind of clear. Fernet Branca.
I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, and from French Market Coffee. French Market Coffee's premium blend beans are locally roasted in small batches, creating a coffee that can only be called New Orleans Bold. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. What kind of liquor is Amaro? Amaro is a traditional bitter Italian digestif. Most Amaro recipes originated in the 19th century, often produced by monks and pharmacists as a stomach remedy. Fernet Branca sets itself apart by having a higher level of alcohol by volume than most. It's 39%. And Fernet Branca also has a lower sugar volume, making it one of the bitterest but most beloved of all Amaros. It's made with a secret combination of 27 herbs, but Amaros are also made with rhubarb, artichokes, unripe green walnuts, and even those pricey black truffles of Umbria. Feeling out of sorts? See if a little sip of Amaro will set you straight. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats.
My head was spinning, I'd felt weird all day. Is that full moon out? I forgot what to say. And so we drank Fernet, deep dug into the night until I felt a bit better. I felt kinda nice. You seem to hang on to every word that I'd say.
Hi, I'm Kathleen Davies from Nip of Courage in Australia.
In Kathleen Davies' words, to start a craft spirit distribution business in the uncharted frontier of Australia, she needed a nip of courage. Giving that name to her venture, Kathleen has since formed a constellation of craft distillers throughout Australia, despite its seemingly impossible liquor laws. Almost out of the woods, Kathleen spoke to us about the ups and downs of her enterprise.
So just to give you a bit of background, the US is about, in terms of land mass, about 1.25 the size of Australia, except the population in Australia is only about 24 million people. So we're all spread across this massive land mass, which makes distribution quite hard. Another thing is people don't realise there's actually about 73 craft distilleries around Australia, but the majority of them are based in rural areas where the economies are fragile and job opportunities are limited. And these guys are very limited with getting, I guess, their whole story out there and what they do, and heavily rely on people coming to them when they're first starting out. So we ended up looking into different ways that we could just be a little bit different from other distributors, and worked out a way where we could actually help market these people, not just move their products from A to B, which is a challenge in itself as well across Australia.
Tell me how you go about finding these small distillers, and talk to me about some of the people who are your clients and their products.
Well, when we first started out, I started by calling people. And what I realized is these guys have had so many people call them in the past and no one's ever really followed through. And so it was when I spoke to a lot of them, it was sort of like, oh, yeah, another person who can represent us. So my husband and I decided, and it was something that my grandfather said, to touch a flesh, look someone in the eye and do business that way. And in the electronic world of today, I think that that's a really nice way of doing business again. And, you know, you can read a lot into people's body language and what people think. And so I literally packed my bag and went out to all these remote distilleries. One distillery in particular in Kununurra, Western Australia, it's in the Kimberley region. Took me about 2 days to get there.
2 days?
Yeah, and about $2,000 in airfares. And it was quite an experience getting out there. And when I finally got out there, I got to see the whole distillery and how they put everything together. They actually make this beautiful aged rum and they grow all their own sugar cane. So it's paddock to bottle. And they do all their own coopering as well, because there's no coopers in that region either. So they rechar the barrels and do everything themselves to recondition them. And that's how I basically, that's an example of how I got some of these people on board. One of my first distillers that we got on board was Peter Bignell in Tasmania. And he's a sixth generation Tasmanian farmer. And unfortunately in Australia, rye whiskey isn't as appreciated as what it is in North America. But he has made some wonderful products, and all the leftover mash from the distilling process he feeds to his sheep, and they in turn provide fertilizer for the next crop of rye. So it's a really, really lovely story.
Take us, if you could, on a virtual tour of what it's like when you visit his distillery. How many employees does he have? He sounds pretty much like a one-man show.
He is a one-man show. When you step into his property, Peter in particular, he's a bit of a mad hoarder. He's got machinery everywhere. A lot of farmers are a bit like that. Spike in the Hoochery in Kununurra in Western Australia is a little bit the same as well. They collect lots of machinery and bits and pieces. And I say, Peter, why have you got that swing set over there? Oh, I might need the steel off that to put something together. You never know when it's going to come into good use. And that
I
sort
guess
of thing.
They're so remote out there.
They are. And his particular distillery is actually in a disused horse stable. So it's actually quite quaint.
So how long has Nip of Courage been in existence?
So it'll just be on 3 years this November. So yeah, we've come a long way in that short amount of time. From day dot, I pretty much started the business on my own and was pounding the pavement with a milk crate on a trolley and, you know, a dozen or so bottles of different spirits. And it was really, really hard in the beginning. In terms of trends, Australia is probably about 5 years behind the whole craft spirit trend compared to the UK and the US. And I would go to a lot of bars and people would say, what are those brands? Never heard of them before. You know, don't waste my time, basically. Whereas the breaking point for my business was actually in Melbourne. It's a very progressive scene in Melbourne. They set a lot of new trends. And the bartenders, when they saw me with this little trolley, would say, what have you got? I'd tell them and they'd say, never heard of it before, come in here and give me some. So it was really, really great. Melbourne really launched our business and has been supportive of everything that we do from the very start. So which
that's
is
fantastic.
Yeah. And we have warehouses all over Australia to overcome the distribution issues in Australia as well.
And what are the are you talking about geographic or
yeah.
I'm also curious about the laws, if there were hurdles that you had to overcome as a liquor distributor?
Geographically in Australia, distribution is a massive challenge for especially small companies like mine. So, for example, Sydney to Perth is like going from New York to LA. The other thing is that's a big challenge for our business is the taxes. So a 700 mil bottle of spirits,
which is your basic fifth here in the United States,
at say 40% alcohol per volume or 80% proof, attracts about $30 in tax.
Break that down for me. So how much does the bottle have to retail for?
Yeah, so for a craft gin, for example, it's between $65 and about $85 per bottle. A lot of them average around $70 or $75, and that includes our tax as well, which is a GST, a tax on a tax.
What a dedication
it
must be to get something like this rolling financially. Are you in the black yet?
Yeah, I'm getting close to it. It's being a startup business, it's a real challenge. Every dollar that we earn over and above our costs, we're reinvesting back into the business, investing in the people that we hire, investing in our marketing, investing in trying to streamline the business more with our distribution model. So it's a challenge financially, but we're giving it everything. My husband and I have remortgaged the house twice. It's been a bit nerve-wracking putting your house on the line, but we believe in what we're doing, and we're totally passionate about the whole craft spirits movement, and we know that it's really going to take off in Australia in the next couple of years.
Have you personally observed the way your business has changed any of these distillers' lives in a significant fashion?
One distillery in particular is now trading in the black. They produce single malt whiskey as well. They used to spend every single weekend going out to markets, in local markets out in the country region, trying to sell their product. It's a funny story. I fell in love with their rum. They dropped a sample off to a bottle shop in Sydney once, and the bottle shop manager said, "Hey, Kathleen, try this. It's bloody beautiful." So I had a little taste and then realised how lovely it was. And I rang them up and said, "I'm coming out to see you." And then when I got there, they had no rum left. But I saw these little bottles in the distance. And I said, "What are those bottles?" And they said, "Oh, it's whiskey, but, you know, you probably wouldn't like it." And I said, "Well, give me a taste." And I absolutely loved it. They do small batch whiskey. It's only like 200 bottles per batch. And so I had a taste and I fell in love with it. And I said, "I'll buy everything you've got here." And Brian didn't know what to say. And he said, "Well, I've got to keep some for the markets and you can't have it all." And I said, "Well, give me what you can." And I took as much as I could that he would give me, and I sold it in a day. I rang him up and I said, "Brian, he's basically 6 hours from Sydney driving." I said, "Brian, it's all gone." And he was just, there was silence on the other end of the phone. He ended up actually coming to Sydney the next day with the remainder of the stock.
Well, that must be so exciting
to
watch this growth in production and be part of it.
Yeah, it is. We're all growing together and our businesses are all evolving together. And, you know, little things like when they come to Sydney, they come and stay at my house. And I love it because I learn so much more each time. And, you know, they've all become friends and we're almost like family, all of us. It's really lovely.
Kathleen Davies, founder of Nip of Courage. Opportunities are available in all walks of life in Australia. So if you're young and you're healthy, why not get a boat and come to Australia?
Hi, my name's Mikey Enright, and I own the Barber Shop in Sydney.
Mikey Enright's desire to become a barber transported him across the globe to a world of scissors and jiggers down under. Now, he owns a combination vintage barber shop and speakeasy-style gin bar in Sydney, Australia, called, what else? The Barber Shop. These days, Mikey is pushing boundaries on a regular basis. During a visit to New Orleans, Mikey gave us a glimpse of his innovative business pairing.
I kind of wanted to create an environment that was a day business and a night business. It's very hard to open a cocktail bar in Sydney, Australia, and trade during the day. People don't drink cocktails in the day like they do in New Orleans. And so I wanted to have a day business originally, but also I wanted to combine, you know, the craft of the cocktail with, you know, with the skill of a barber, and then combine those two lifestyles together so that you can have a great drink whilst you kind of get your hair cut or your beard trimmed or styled or whatever you like.
So have people begun drinking in the daytime too, because the barbershop's open in the daytime?
Yes.
Oh, you corrupter. You corrupter of people just looking for a little trim. So how has that evolved? Tell me about how you've changed that pattern.
Well, you know, the barbershop thing, people started getting haircut at hairdressers and that kind of stuff over the last 20, 30, 40 years. There's a renaissance with the barbershop. You know, guys, generally men, are going back to getting the haircut at barbershops again and having that tradition and that sort of style of thing. So I just wanted to bring that back too, you know. So, and it works harmoniously with the bar. We have lots of different packages where people can have whiskey flights with certain sort of haircuts and whatever they haven't done.
Describe for me how you have seen that culture shift since you're shaking things up.
Well, I think, you know, in Sydney, Australia, the population is very small. You know, it's not like a big city like New York or London where there are lots of people about in the daytime. So, you know, come Thursday, Friday, people do drink in the daytime, but generally not early week. So, you know, from my side, I wanted to have that day business, but it's a tough one. It's not like the US or Great Britain or Asia in the sense of, you know, there's no free martini lunches going on. Uh-huh. You know, people are very conservative in the daytime, and then they kind of let their hair down at night or get a cut.
So what are the kind of services do you offer besides haircuts?
Right, okay, we do the traditional hot towel cutthroat shave.
Hot towel cutthroat shave.
Yes.
That's a good one. I don't know that expression, cutthroat shave.
Right, okay.
It sounds kind of scary.
It does sound scary. It's not as scary as what it sounds. Basically, you know, you get the hot and cold towels. You get moisturized after it. And, you know, we give the closest shave that you can possibly have. It's a really nice experience.
Yeah, that's great. So what other services? Tell me a little bit more about the other things that you all offer.
Well, in Sydney and most parts of Australia, there's a big sort of subculture called hipsters.
Yes, do we know the hipsters. We have them here too.
They're everywhere. So basically with the hipsters, you know, they like to, you know, keep their grooming up to scratch. So kind of beard trimming, mustache waxing, and that kind of stuff.
Mikey, in your book, what's a hipster?
Well, that's an interesting question. Right, okay. A hipster generally is somebody with lots of facial hair. They manage and look after their facial hair. You know, they drink great spirits. Yeah, they eat great food. But they want to look like a down and outer.
Isn't that interesting? What do you think's driving that need to want to look like a down and outer?
You know, it's like most things, it's another trend that they're going through.
Okay, so before you were a cocktail enthusiast and bartender, you were a barber. So how did you set out on that course as your life's work originally?
Okay, you're going to love this one. Basically, when I was growing up in England, I wanted to move to Australia. You know, I love England, but I didn't want to live there. So back in the late 80s, if you basically studied and trained as a hairdresser, they were in demand in Australia, so you could get a visa a lot easily.
It was all about your dream of the sun.
Yes.
So there's the barbershop, but then there's also the bar. So what's the experience like in the bar? I think you have to walk through the barbershop to get to the bar. Is that correct?
That's correct, yeah. Yeah, so basically the barbershop is open from 8 a.m. till 8 p.m. every day. So, you know, if you arrive at the bar before 8 p.m., then you get to walk through the barbershop and see the guys working and doing their craft. The actual cocktail bar itself is predominantly a gin bar. You know, we stock a lot of different gins. We have a lot of different style gin cocktails. The barbershop has three chairs, got 120 capacity in the back. So, you know, we have a pretty good atmosphere.
It sounds like quite a party. So you actually do have the largest rare and modern gin and Jennifer collection.
Yes.
How many gins?
Oh, we've got probably just over 100 at the moment.
And a lot of people may not even know who are listening what Jennifer is. Explain that.
Yeah, okay. So Jennifer is basically the first original gin. Yeah, it's juniper focused. It does have a slightly different taste, but Jennifer came before gin.
Ah, and yeah. Where does it originate from?
Holland.
So do you make mixed drinks with that too?
Yeah, we have a pretty, you know, sizable Jennifer collection. A lot of those Jennifers that we do have, you can't get in Australia. So we get them straight from Holland, from the House of Bowls. It is very different, you know. Basically, the term Dutch courage comes from Jennifer. Yeah, so when they went out to war, they used to have a slug of Jennifer. Yeah,
and
so
then
that's
you'd
quite
be ready to jump into the battle, huh?
Yeah, yeah. And then you go to war. On a nice note.
Well, Mikey, describe for me some of the cocktails that you might be mixing there. What are you doing that's so different and special besides the haircut and a cutthroat?
We pride ourselves on all the best service that we can possibly give, and outside of that, you know, the best ingredients too. With cocktails, you know, we're quite experimental in terms of we use like lots of fresh fruits. We use custard apple, rhubarb, which is traditionally English.
What's a custard apple? I think a lot of people might not know what that is.
Yeah, it's a hybrid of an apple. It's not something that you could chew on. It doesn't hold much moisture, so you've got to put it through a slow-press juicer, and then you get like a kind of fluffy texture of an apple. Oh. It's very soft compared to, like, you know, your regular sort of style apple. So it's like a hybrid. So we use lots of interesting ingredients like that. We also, you know, give a bit of a nod back to the historic record of gin cocktails. You know, we do lots of different variations on classic gin cocktails too. At the moment, I'm working on a hair care range.
A hair care range.
Yes. So I'm working with a scent house. So we're looking at putting the scent of gin into hair cream, moisturiser, beard oil, shave cream and the likes.
Well, that's a regular manly scent, isn't it?
Yeah.
Nothing like a little scent of juniper.
Well, I just think that, you know, I think the future is really, from what I can see, is, you know, you broaden that creativity. And as it turns out, a lot of the botanicals that you do find in gin are beneficial, you know, to hair, skin and nails, you know. So, I mean, you know, it's all good for you too.
Mikey Enright, owner of the Barber Shop in Sydney, Australia. This could be the day that we push through. It could be the day that all our dreams come true. For me. Somewhere at the end of just
That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Next week, we'll be pulling some pranks for April Fools. The wild stories we've collected will have you guessing. Is that true, or is that an April Fool's joke?
Rap is dead with a hole through it. He's just like, drop dead. We're like, oh my God. Moving four-wheeler, moving rabbit. With a pistol, pretty proud of myself. It saved the season. Like, didn't kill a deer, but I wired up the rabbit.
Have you missed an episode of Louisiana Eats? Hear today's show or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com, where you can also subscribe to the podcast and take us with you wherever you go. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, French Market Coffee, and Rouse's Markets. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau and by Tableau, Dickie Brennan's latest restaurant serving local Creole cuisine with a view of Jackson Square. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to producers Joe Schreiner,
Sarah Holtz, and Reggie Morris. Come visit us anytime in our Louisiana Eats studios at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. I'm Poppy Tooker. Louisiana Eats is a production of Poppy Tooker Broadcasting.